Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna talk about your copper pour and whether it's too close to some of your traces. Now, this is usually looked at in terms of manufacturability, which is a good way to go. I mean, if it isn't manufacturable, then why would you even design it? But there's another aspect to this which relates to signal integrity and impedance. And so it's fair to ask, when is your ground pour too close to your microstrips or your strip lines? So let's look at this from the signal integrity and impedance perspective. We're looking at the top view of a PCB. Could be an internal layer, could also be an external layer. Let's just say for a moment that this is your trace. And if you've put some copper pour around that trace, one question that you should be asking yourself is, what should this clearance be? So let's just call it S for the moment. So what clearance should you use? I think, as I mentioned in the intro, that the first place to look is manufacturing, okay? So the manufacturer that you're going to use to have this board produced is going to specify some minimum value for this spacing, okay? And that's fair, that should be the first place to start. Make sure you don't get so close that you are violating their minimum value. But there's another perspective to this, which is, how does this pour affect the impedance of your trace? Now, if you remember, when we've talked about transmission lines, let's say that this is just a controlled impedance line, okay? So it has some inductance, and then back to the ground plane, there is some capacitance. However, and I'm just gonna space this out just a little bit more so that I've got room to draw. However, there is also some capacitance that exists between this line and the nearby pour, okay? And so this capacitance essentially adds in parallel to this capacitance that defines the characteristic impedance. So here, we're gonna call this C sub P, so this is a parasitic capacitance. And let's just say that this spacing is the same as this spacing, that means this parasitic capacitance is gonna be equal to that parasitic capacitance. So I'm kind of lumping this all together here because we're ignoring fringing fields, but this is just kind of a simple example to show why getting this spacing too close is not necessarily a good thing if you wanna make sure that this trace has the same impedance without any ground pour as it does with the ground pour. So here, my new, we'll just call it Z prime, my new impedance with this spacing between the ground pour and my trace is gonna be equal to square root of L sub zero, so that's this native inductance of the trace, divided by C sub zero, so this is the C that would be going back to ground as we would normally define it for a transmission line, plus 2 times this parasitic capacitance, because remember, this is effectively in parallel with this and with this. So it increases our parasitic capacitance. If this spacing is not too close, we may not decrease Z too much and get to a situation where we are now violating our impedance target. So let's say that we were aiming for, you know, 50 ohms, but we might have a tolerance of, you know, plus minus 5%, right? Well, 5% is gonna be plus minus 2.5 ohms. So you can only bring this spacing so close that you don't decrease this impedance by any more than 2.5 ohms. How do you figure out what this S value is? Because depending on the width of this trace, this required spacing could actually be much larger than the spacing, the minimum spacing that would be required by your fabricator to ensure that you can actually manufacture the board. Now here, we might be looking at a surface layer, we might be looking at an internal layer. And you, if you then remember that these values, L0 and C sub zero, are gonna be different for strip lines versus microstrips, you then need to say, okay, how does this S value change if I'm in an internal layer versus an external layer? If you are gonna use ground pour on the surface layer, and I mean, there are reasons to do so, or if you are gonna use ground pour on an internal layer, again, there are plenty of reasons to do so, People can argue for reasons not to do so. If you are going to do it and you need to maintain this trace to a specific impedance, how can you do that to ensure that you can still route in and out of this ground pore without changing the impedance appreciably? So this is where you need to make creative use of a field solver. So you can do it with Altium Designer's Layer Stack Manager if you like, and you can do that by comparing just a microstrip with a coplanar arrangement with ground, okay? And you can do those calculations in the Layer Stack Manager in Altium Designer. Now, there is a rule of thumb here, and I kind of have a love-hate relationship with rules of thumb, and I'll explain why in just a moment. But there is a rule of thumb here that specifies what this spacing should be, and it is sometimes called the 3W rule. Not to be confused with other 3W rules, because there are multiples of them. But this 3W rule says that if this distance is my width, W, then S, this spacing, should be 3 times that. So if my trace width is 12, let's say it's 12 mils, the spacing should be 36 mils. And that's what that rule says. So using a field solver, you can actually determine what is the appropriate width. And I'll just give you a spoiler alert now. Like most rules of thumb that are based on spacing, they can be a little too conservative. This is definitely one of those ones that I would say is a little too conservative. So let's look at some simulation results and I'll show you why. So what I want to look at here is I want to look at some simulation results, and I've published these in a blog on Altium's website, and they are sometimes a bit difficult to read. Simulation results can be like that. And so what I'm gonna do is actually walk you through some of these graphs and explain what they mean, and especially explain how they help you determine what the appropriate clearance is between your trace and your ground pore on a layer. So as I mentioned, having ground pore too close to a trace can modify its impedance. And in order to see how those two things are related, first we need to pick a particular trace geometry. So here in this graph, I'm showing microstrips and surface coplanar waveguides, and then strip line, and then an internal coplanar waveguide. So the surface waveguide, the surface coplanar arrangement, is basically a microstrip with ground pore around it, and then the internal coplanar arrangement is just a strip line with ground pore around it. So looking here on this graph, you can see there's several different curves. And what this is telling you is this is the trace width that you would need to hit 50 ohm impedance if you had 5 mil clearance for a given dielectric thickness. So the dielectric thickness is here on the x-axis. And then on the y-axis, I have the trace width, right? So the 5 mil clearance is the clearance around the width of the trace. That is, you know, your clearance between your trace edge and the edge of your ground pore. So as you can see, you know, you get something that you expect, right? If you increase the dielectric thickness, you require a larger trace width in order to keep 50 ohms impedance. And so what you can actually do is you can go a little bit further, and instead of just looking at one clearance, what we can do is we can look at the trace width without copper pore versus the trace width with pore. What this is telling you is that this is the minimum clearance that you need on the y-axis to hit 50 ohms with a specific trace width. So remember, the reason the trace width is increasing here is because you're increasing h, and here I'm using h as the distance between the trace and its reference plane. So this is specifically for the coplanar arrangement. So if we go back just for a moment, you know, what we're doing is we're comparing the trace width for the coplanar arrangement, remember that's with the ground pore, versus the case of just a microstrip or just a strip line without any ground pore. And so what's interesting here is that you can see when we start adding in the pore, we can actually get to a smaller trace width. And so that's what these two, you know, the blue and the red curve are showing you. Same thing for the black and the green curve. When we add in that microstrip, or when we add in that ground pore, I should say, around the trace, we can actually have a slightly smaller trace width. So going back over here, this is just summarizes this for various values of H, and it shows you what the minimum clearance needed is. So this is really important because it allows us to test this 3W rule. And one of the things that you see when you in PCB design, when you have these rules where it's like the 3W rule or the 20H rule or the other 3W rule, there are actually multiple 3W rules, whatever the number plus letter rule is, usually they are a bit overly conservative. And so this is one of those cases where you can actually test that and show that the rule is a bit over conservative. It's okay to over design sometimes. It's okay to be a little conservative and follow something like a 3W rule if you don't know how to run one of these simulations. That's perfectly appropriate. Some rules of thumbs are not to be followed and should be tested before you follow them. Sometimes spacing rules though, like spacing rules for crosstalk or for ensuring impedance, they're usually overly conservative, and we're gonna show that here in this next graph. So in this next graph, what I've done is I've looked at the clearance to width ratio, okay? So what is the clearance between the edge of the trace and the ground pour nearby? And looking at this ratio for different dielectric thicknesses lets you see exactly when you can violate the 3W rule and still maintain 50 ohms impedance, as I've shown here on the graph. So for a microstrip, you can actually get a lot of violation here. Even when you're at very high layer thickness, 10 mils, I mean, you're getting this clearance to width ratio down to a ratio of 1. So meaning if your width is, let's say your width is 10 mils, then your clearance would be just a little bit more than that. So this is about 1.1 on this graph. So that would be about, you know, 11 mils. For strip line, it's a little bit larger, but even when we get down to very small layer thicknesses, so here you can see I'm down to, you know, this looks like about 3 mil dielectric thickness, so really thin dielectric for routing strip lines. Even then, we're still below 3. So we still beat this ratio of 3 that was is specified in the 3W rule. So here it's at about, that's 2.6, 2.7. So it's about 2.7. So meaning if your strip line width was, let's say it's 10 mils, just for to throw out a number. If it was 10 mils, then your clearance would need to be 2.7 times that, or 27 mils. But once we get to thicker layer, thicker dielectrics, you see that ratio drops off, and it drops off very fast. So here where we're at, you know, 8 mil dielectric thickness, you can see that the ratio is actually 1.5. So all of these results really nicely show that the 3W rule is a bit overly conservative. Again, not always a bad thing with spacing rules. In general, spacing rules are designed to ensure a few different things. One of them is manufacturability. So if you pack things too close, there is the danger that, like with drill hits, let's say, that you miss a drill hit and it puts a drill hit in the wrong location, or it just totally severs a trace from its pad. So clearances are important in manufacturing. The other reason is for something like crosstalk. Really the best way to overcome crosstalk problems in a PCB is spacing. That's usually your first line of defense. So those are the two major reasons that we worry about those kinds of rules, is manufacturability and kind of the bare bones signal integrity stuff. There's actually an article I'm gonna post in the description, and that article goes over some of the really common rules of thumbs and gives you some stuff to think about with rules of thumb in terms of whether you should follow them or whether they should probably be ignored and, you know, go your own way. Okay, everybody, so hopefully this helps you think about when it's appropriate to use grounded copper pour near your impedance controlled traces and why this actually modifies the impedance. It's that parasitic capacitance that you have between the trace and any nearby copper. So if you want to be able to run these calculations yourself, you can go get a free trial of All Team Designer. You get a 15-day free trial. You can play around with the Layer Stack Manager. You can access the Field Solver. You can do all these calculations, and you can come up with your own spacing rules if you want. Go get that link. It's in the description. Hit this like button. Hit the subscribe button if you want to see more of these videos. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them in the comments section. We love hearing your questions. All right, thanks everybody, and don't forget to call your fabricator.